pick a large alpha, you're going to make type 1 error more often. If you pick a small alpha, you're going to make a type 1 error less often.
What's the benefit of picking a larger alpha?
Okay, so the benefit of picking a large alpha is you make a type 2 error less often, okay? Because these two are interplaying, okay? So type 1 error is alpha, okay? The probability of a type 2 error we assign as beta, okay? So alpha is the first letter in the alphabet, beta is the second letter in the alphabet, so you can remember alpha and beta that way, okay? And think about it. If we pick a small alpha, okay, with small alpha, we would be rejecting the null hypothesis. We would be rejecting the null hypothesis less often, right? So if I have alpha 0.01 versus alpha 0.05, the only time I would be rejecting the null hypothesis is if my p-value is smaller than alpha, okay? So if my cutoff is now at 0.01, I would be rejecting it less often because alpha is a lot smaller, okay? So with small alpha, I reject H0 less often, okay? So I'm not rejecting the null hypothesis more often, okay? And if I'm not rejecting it more often, then I'm increasing my risk of a type 2 error, okay? With small alpha, I reject H0 less often, okay? So lower chance of type 1 error, higher chance of type 2 error. Okay? On the other hand, with large alpha, okay, I reject H0 less often, which means higher chance of type 1 error. With large alpha, I'm rejecting H0 more often. That something sounded funny. Higher chance of type 1 error. Lower chance of type 2 error. So I'll give two scenarios, each with different implications of type 1 and type 2 error. Okay, so think about a smoke or fire smoke detector or smoke alarm. And the smoke alarm, basically, the null hypothesis is that there is no fire. And the alternative hypothesis is that there is a fire. Okay? And the smoke alarm has two jobs. And one is very obvious. Okay? The first job is, if there's a fire, it's supposed to sound an alarm, okay? And the other job is maybe so inherent or trivial that you forget to think about it, but it's also very important, which is if there's no fire, it's supposed to be quiet, okay? That's the other job of a smoke alarm. Otherwise, if either of those malfunction, you have a bad fire alarm or bad smoke detector, okay? So in this case, so if I set up this grid, the truth is H0 is true, H0 is false, and the decision is do not reject. Okay, so this decision is to be silent. And then the other decision is reject reach zero. This is to sound the alarm. So sounding the alarm when there's a fire, this is correct. Sounding the alarm when there is no fire, or staying silent when there's no fire, that's correct. Okay. H0, type, this is a type 2 error. In this case, this is silent, but there's a fire. Here, this is a type 1 error. This is an alarm, but no fire. Okay, so with a smoke alarm, what type of error is worse than the other?
Type 2 is worse.
Type 2 is worse, right? It's much more worse if the, the smoke alarm is not making noise, but there's a fire going on. Okay, so if type 2 is worse, do we want to pick a large alpha or a small alpha?
Large.
We want to pick a large alpha. Okay, so type 2 error is worse. So pick a large alpha. Okay, and what that means is the smoke alarms are designed in